And you have the big monstrosity.
Jim recommends.
We'll stay by.
I go home and put your mouth and leave me back up. Because I've been here, I just had to thank Richard and told him that I'm killed. I just have to give Richard to Xanax, so he doesn't get too bad.
And that's where this.
Anybody get on that guy in Comanche?
He's still, I've been driving by a little bit, I drove by today.
He hasn't moved anything.
Done nothing?
No. Appreciate it though.
Yeah, he runs a business, do you know where his business is at?
Pardon?
Do you know where his business is at? I think it's on Vendors on Main Street.
No, I don't even know what he does. All I know is he's, at least he's even more cluttered now.
Where's Comanche?
Oh, by Cumon, just, not Cumon, just.
Yeah. I'm Bird Comanche. Yeah, you know.
I've been trying.
I'm not the guy who wants to go around saying, you know, your stuff is junk or anything, I just want it to look presentable, it's a residence, it's not a storage area. And that's what it's treated like, I mean, he's got more stuff there. Yes.
I'll swing by tomorrow and.
Yeah.
I've been trying, to hunt him down, because he said he has a business here in Cliffside.
Yeah.
So trying to find this guy in his life is like.
I don't, no, like I said, from what I understand, he doesn't own the property.
That's what I'm finding out too.
Yeah. You know, everything's in turmoil because of the roads and everything over there right now, not too many people are looking at it. I had to drive by it every day. I kind of took it on as a responsibility. Appreciate if you go over and wrap up.
No, not a problem, yeah.
You know, as far as I'm concerned, if he doesn't do anything, then it's time to move on him.
No, I know, I.
Yeah, he's had plenty of time.
All week, I've already given him quite a bit of months.
Thank you. You're about as ready as I am.
Old Clarence. Clarence.
There is no.
Please come to order. Work session of Town of Portside Common Council for Monday, February 4th, 2019 is now in session. Do we have a member of the audience wishing to give the invocation? Seeing none, Pastor Bruce.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank the Town of Portside and for the people that are visiting, for the residents here. God, we're asking for wisdom and guidance in doing the town's business and to benefit everybody that comes here and lives here. Bless our meeting, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Please remain standing and join me as we honor our nation's flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible,
please call the roll.
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Schwartz.
Present.
Councilmember Schut. Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Goldberg.
Here.
Councilmember Hager.
Here.
Announcements. We have work session.
Mayor.
Item one.
Under announcements, there's one item inadvertently left off. I'd like to make an announcement. We as a town realized that during the shutdown that there were some issues related to trash. And so we went to the effort to get a few more dumpsters out. I think you're all aware of that. The council felt that we at least should try to accommodate. I received a card, and it says, Dear Town Manager, thank you for advertising Courtside's accommodating offer of trash disposal during our latest government shutdown. My husband, Eric, and I were concerned about properly discarding our trash when we arrived at Skadden Wash on January 25th. We were both surprised to find a trailer-sized dumpster. The transfer station north of town has limited days and hours. We appreciate the town's hospitality to RVers and the extra steps taken to care of our needs in your community. Sincerely, individual, get their name, but it's nice to get thank you, recognition for those steps. Certainly our out-of-town folks need a little assistance because with the government being shut down. So just wanted you to know about that.
Work session, item one, business license ordinance. Review and discussion of an amendment to the town code repealing existing Article 8-1 vendor sales permit and Article 8-2 business license code and adopting new Article 8-1 Business License Code to update and simplify the town's process for issuing business license.
Mayor, Councilmember, we have the item number one that you're dealing with, Business License Code. There are three that we're going to be talking about tonight. They're kind of interrelated, but I really believe that maybe this being our first work session on it, the best thing would be to just kind of start through it and just take them from the very beginning. We usually find ourselves getting a little bit off track with that process, but I still think that that's a good thing for us to do, especially since our attorney is going to have to take the kinds of things that come from the meeting tonight to go back and make the changes. If we're not jumping around, it'll be a lot easier. I know that there's a lot of folks here tonight. Really appreciate the folks that are here to kind of help us see the impact of this, what the ramifications are of these changes. And it'll also be helpful, I think, to us to get that kind of in an orderly fashion rather than jumping ahead, which could easily happen. So, with that being said, I think, Mayor, I'll just turn it back to you as the head of the council to proceed through it.
Okay. First, I'd like to bring your attention to the fact that the front page says the red lines show the change from the ordinance reviewed at this meeting, and it was printed in black and white, not in color, and the red lines do not show up, so we don't have red lines on this, particularly the first section, item one, the section on the license.
The red X shows up in kind of a purple, but it's very difficult.
Might be good to assume all these might have some red or color and just print them all in colors. That way it doesn't cost any extra on the ink if it's not used. Okay. Article 8-1, Business License Code. Council.
Just a question. I have two copies. And I have one that's flagged with a bright yellow. Is that the one that we're looking at tonight?
Well,
That's up to you. The two copies, the first one is a redlined version from the version you discussed last time, which had changes that were directed by the council at that meeting. It might be easier to go with the clean, to just go through the clean copy. But the clean.
The second copy.
The second one contains all of those changes. There weren't that, there weren't that.
And I apologize if I'm a little ignorant because I was not here last meeting. So I'm kind of going through this, but I apologize for not being here, but I just want to make sure we're on the same pages. So it's your suggestion that we go, I look down at the bottom here, it says SDG, SDG. Date, and then it says date 1/32/19. That's the one which you want us to go through, right?
I believe that would be the easiest because of the problem with the granting of the thing.
The second version does match the as corrected version. So if we went over the changes that are actually highlighted, we should be able to go through them pretty quick. Page one, any questions, any corrections, anything you see on page one on Article 8.1 on business license?
Well, this is just kind of a general thing, and you need to let me know if I'm wrong, but in my opinion, the town should be capitalized throughout this document because it's a synonym for the town of Quartzsite. But in some places it's capitalized and in others it's not.
I think I went back to, I don't know what the protocol is, but we're going to be codifying this and there'll be one protocol throughout. I cannot remember whether or not Quartzsite code throughout capitalizes T or not. I usually would have capitalized if it was, but.
Sometimes it is.
Let's go through the business license code, page one. Anyone see anything that is not corrected? Page two. Definitions, anything there?
Could I sort of talk about some of the structure a little bit, just because you will see there, I inserted the definition of mobile merchant, although that's in a different article. All the definitions I wanted in one place. Mobile merchants is an attached too, so that's why that's inserted. And I did realize, as I mentioned last time, the park and swap provisions were not. I had picked those up because I didn't quite understand the significance, but I do now after the last discussion. And so I put in the same park and swap operator and vendor provisions that are in existing 8-1, which is the vendor permit section, are in this ordinance.
Page three, and then the problems with page three.
Just a question down on the bottom, in section 8-1-2, delegation of authority, there's a blank there. Are we going to later on determine who that is?
Yes, the blanks there throughout.
Right. Okay.
The one in town clerk should be capitalized as well as it's a private.
If you want all of the titles and town capitalized, we'll do that.
I concur.
Page four, anyone have any questions on four? Eight 8.1.6 on the first, it's the as corrected.
Okay, section 8.1.6, it just says the word name. And I think we're looking for the business name. I think we just need to be more specific about which kind of name. And also, I think on the addresses, it says permanent and local, but it doesn't say anything about mailing. And mailing address in this town is really important. South Dakota, but have a local address here then they have the business address, which is listed on here, but nowhere does it say mailing address.
So should permanent and local be permanent and local mailing address?
It should, not necessarily, because their permanent address might be in South Dakota. Their local address where they live may be on Duke Lane, but their business address may be on Main Street. But none of those three address the mailing address, which is the only address that they can receive any kind of communication from the town of Quartzsite.
And it's a post office box.
And it has to be a post office box.
So I think paragraph B is the one that needs to be changed. And it should say street and mailing address.
Okay, you're talking about 8-1-6, right?
8-1-6, correct. Information required.
Because on mine it has A, name, B, permanent mailing address, C, business address.
Are you before or after?
You're on the first one, you go to the second.
I'm on the one I worked with. And what you're talking about is on the margins.
I didn't make any changes to that. It's, all of them should say permanent and local address.
Okay, I'm on the right one.
But what I'm saying is that it doesn't say anything about mailing address.
So we want that to say permanent and local mailing address.
I think so, yeah. Because if they're going to be receiving any kind of communication from the town, they can get it in South Dakota, but they aren't going to get it if they live in Quartzsite.
So which copy are we working on?
The second copy.
No.
Well, the first copy will shows us which items were changed, and then we can verify by turning to it on the second copy to see the as corrected. My question on that is, when it's asking for a name, is it asking for the name of the business or the name of the individual that's applying for the business license?
The vice mayor asked that after name we insert of business.
Okay, but what about the individual that's applying for the license? Is there somewhere where we're going to have that on record?
We should probably add applicant name.
Thank you. Anyone else on page 4 of the information? Okay, page 5. Anyone have anything on page 5?
Yes.
Mike? Yeah, go ahead.
Letter E.
Which section?
Okay.
Which section?
818. That's the one right above 818. It's on 817, letter E.
Section 817E.
The license holder shall be in time over.
Well, and maybe I need to go back on the other one and see. You know, the other one says basically the same thing.
Yeah.
It's just, it just seems like it's a very long and confusing.
The first sentence is in your existing code. The second sentence, which reads, the issuance of a license shall not be evidence that the town knew or should have known that another permit, certificate, or examination was required. I looked at other codes and thought that would be a good addition, because the mere issuance by the town of a license should not be taken to mean that you've examined whether there are other permits or licenses that have to be obtained. So that's why I added that. We can take it out if you want it. It's not in your existing code, the second sentence.
Albeit a little wordy, I think that does make sense to put that in.
Enough code writers or enough cities and towns thought it was important that it's in most of the other codes.
Oh, yeah. 8-1-7.
We try to check.
Okay.
on letter D, it says that a business license application shall be submitted to planning and zoning.
For zoning review.
Does that mean just new ones? Or if somebody relocates? Because planning and zoning is going to do nothing but be reviewing business license for a year if everybody that has a business license has to go before planning and zoning before it's... I mean, my business has been in the same place for 9 years. Why would I have to go before planning and zoning to get a business license this year?
You don't have to go before planning and zoning. This is the planning and zoning department. And the reason for that is and one of the reasons you want to issue business licenses is to be sure that you know that the business that is going into that location actually is permitted to be in that zone. It's one of the reasons you do business licenses, to be sure that you can know that information.
Well, I don't have a problem with a new or relocating business, but that's not what this says. It says the business license application must be submitted to the planning and zoning. So that to me says everybody's business licenses. And I don't know that should mean everybody, because there's a lot of them like mine that's been in the same place for 9 years.
Well, we could say new business license.
New or relocating.
What about seasonal? We're talking about a seasonal business license. Do they have to go in front of planning and zoning?
It's not in front of planning. It's
the staff.
Yeah, okay. Staff looks at it, says, yep, they're permitted, that a retail business is permitted in the C1 district.
It's not the planning and zoning commission, it's the planning. Okay.
So what does it matter? You turn in your paper, it goes into the back room, into the dark hole, and then it comes out and you've got a license.
Sort of, I guess. But it's a box to be checked. It's in your existing code. I didn't make it up.
So are we saying that letter D should say the new business license application?
Yes, and I probably need to look at... I'm not finding a separate section on renewals, but...
In looking over, I don't remember which one was, but there is somewhere in here, there is mention for existing businesses and that.
Okay. 815 deals with renewal licenses. Well, and it does say all renewals of licenses shall be subject to zoning review.
And I think that should remain, because what happens if the person suddenly has to move, they decide to go off world and do work somewhere else, like, you know, they went in a casket somewhere, and now the business is changing, and the license came in, and how would they know if they just automatically approve it?
I think that's what Loretta was saying, that if we put in there new or relocating businesses.
But you wouldn't know if somebody just up and left.
Well, they're supposed to give us notice.
That they have to let us know that if they move or they terminate, it's their responsibility to let us know. That's in your area.
And if they don't?
Well, they don't get a business license because they have to apply for a business license every year.
Okay, I think you're missing my point. I'm probably misstating it. If somebody moves, leaves the business, leaves the location, and they don't do their part and come in and say that they've moved, then there's no way to check to find out if they have moved unless it's going through the process. And it's just paperwork, going through the process, verifying that the business is what it is. Maybe they changed what they do, and that may change their status. I understand your business is stable, but there's a lot of others that change.
Well, I know, but they wouldn't get a business license unless they made an application.
Right. But they would.
They don't just print out business licenses. You have to make an application.
So everyone has to have an application and go through the process.
That's correct. And if they don't make an application, they don't get a business license. So if they move, they won't have to apply.
Okay, but you were saying that you shouldn't have to go through the process because you're always there.
Less.
Just the application process, Jen, for business is already there.
Jen, are you waiting to speak?
Well, I would like to speak on what you guys are discussing. And here's the way that some of the things have happened. relatives inherit businesses, and since they have never ran the business or been associated with it, they don't have a clue. So they don't, a lot of times, have the wherewithal to come into town hall and say, hey, my dad passed away, and I am now in charge of this business, and I need to pull a business license. They don't do that. So without that kind of a process in place that you all are discussing, we don't know that the new person has now become in charge of the business. And because that person's never been in charge before, he has no idea what situations are attached to that business, such as conditional use permits, etc. And so that's the reason why they all need to go through planning and zoning. So we can make sure that if a new business moves in there, the business that they're doing in that structure is appropriate for the building. A new business moves in where there was chemical testing prior, do they know that? And is it been improperly cleaned up so the new business can move in without issues, because there might have been chemical testing in there previous? Do you see what I'm saying? There's a lot of issues attached to this. So it's good that all businesses go through this, because then you know that this person passed away, their relative is now in charge, that relative now has to figure out, he has to get his own business license, and he has to meet the requirements of the town. Without that process in place, he's not going to know what the town requirements are for his business. He's just going to keep operating on a deceased relative's business license.
Now, this is Planning and Zoning Department for review, not Planning and Zoning Commission.
Correct.
Application.
Correct.
But do we not...
There are occasionally issues that are related to non-conforming businesses. And the reason why I would like to see it there, even though it, you know, if a business has been there for 9 years, there's not an awful lot of time that needs to be spent. But sometimes we'll have a situation, as Janet pointed out, that just a cursory review of that property file shows us that there is a non-conforming use there that the new owner needs to be aware of, that could be quite significant in terms of how they operate there. But, you know, it's, we as a staff have already determined there's going to be some procedural things that we're going to have to spend more time on, simply because we've tried to accommodate some of these licenses immediately, and then later on found that there was something in the property file that changed how we would have handled that. It would be easier if it were a requirement. So even though it might only take 15 minutes, somebody's responsible to go look at that file and double check.
Do we send a renewal notice out? That's not a question. We do send a renewal notice out. And on that renewal notice, maybe that's where, you know, has anything changed?
Sometimes what's changed is the mailing address, and they
right.
Don't get it. You know, we have a lot of those.
My name is Shanine Bergette, and I'm the current vendor clerk for the town of Quartzsite. And I have read through this documentation, and while I appreciate the council wanting to make the process simpler, I think it's a very big mistake to separate out the vendor section, especially when it comes to what you were just talking about. These people, some of them are only here for 3 days, some of them are only here for 10 days. How are they going to have to wait out the process? They're not going to be able to do business. So if it relates to the vendors, it should be a separate way of saying it. they can't wait 15 days to get a license.
Well, there is a whole separate section on vendors in here. This is business licenses.
Yeah.
But for people like the Gold Shop, The Gold Store, he has a permanent business location here, but he also vends. So he would have to have a business license, and then, according to our news, not have to have a vendor's license. But there is another section in here that has specifics about what they call the mobile vendor, which is the in and outs.
No. That's a different,
Oh, sorry.
Let me explain what we did, and we had a discussion at an earlier meeting that, a couple of months ago, and part of the discussion was how to simplify this business licensing, vendor licensing code provisions. And you previously, or existing currently, there's Article 8-1, that's just vendor permits. And it covered vendor permits, vendor registration, several hoops that had to be jumped through. Article 8-2 was business licenses. What we discussed at the study session that I'm not remembering the date of was that we have a section on business licenses. That's the umbrella. Within business licenses, we take care of what we're calling seasonal vendors. Those are the 180 days or less. And so that is provided for in section 8-1-7, which provides for seasonal vendors, licenses for seasonal vendors shall expire 180 days after the date of issuance. So that's how we took care of the seasonal vendors. If that's not the direction you want to go, I really recommend, I'm just going to tell you, because I've studied this code now, I really recommend that we do the business license structure, and then we just deal simply with the seasonal vendors in maybe a more simplified process, perhaps, but not have a whole new article where you've got two sets of regulations, which I found very confusing when I was trying to understand it.
Thank you for that, and that's basically what I think is necessary, is a separate article on the vendors, because I'll just give you some figures. The 2017-18 budget was $57,000, of which $50,193 was collected. This year's budget, 2018-19, was $55,000, and we have collected to date $52,290. If following the vendors under the business license, where they do not have to have a separate permit for each location, the town will lose about $10,000, and that's just a guesstimate of what I was able to look at on my schematics. And I do a schematic on the large shows, such as the RV show, the powwow, Cellarama, rock show, desert gardens. I do a schematic on those, and those show where the vendors are located. If they're highlighted in yellow, that means they have complied with everything that the vendor needs to comply with. If they're not highlighted in yellow, that means there's where we have to go and say, you need a permit. Going through this business license, if the vendors have to do the same kind of thing and do not have to register where they are located, how are we going to find them? So I just thought you should know that there is a chance for a loss of revenue if some of these are not kept separate. Thank you.
Thank you.
So what you're saying is XYZ Company is over here vending, and they have a vendor's permit. Then they also go over to another
location.
I thought if they change location, they would have to come in to town hall and report locations so that we would know if they were vending in various locations. That's what I thought, anyway.
That's how the schematic helps us, because we can see that if they're at Desert Gardens and then they move to the powwow, they have to have a permit for each location if they're open at the same time. If they...
Currently.
Right.
Currently.
If they shut down at Desert Gardens and go to the QIA for that show, then they take that permit with them.
Okay, because I've got a client that has a permanent business and right now is in vending in at least three, maybe four different locations other than his main business.
Well, the last meeting, let's talk as to somebody who's got a permanent business and then goes to, say, a swap meet. At the last meeting, you instructed that that person would not be required to get a separate license.
Not necessarily a separate license, but I think that they need to tell us of each of the locations where they are vending. Now, they may not need another separate permit for each of those locations, but then we ought to at least know where they are and that they have that primary business license.
So there does need to be a registering process, so we have documentations
for separate locations to help with what she's doing.
Exactly. But recognizing at the same time what's been pointed out, that this is an area where we are saying we will be foregoing some revenue, because those individuals now will not have to pay for all of those other spaces as long as they are vending in the same fashion that their business license is established. They can't have a vending booth that is totally a different business.
There is one business in Forsyth alone that vends at five locations. So if he's able to use that one license at all five of those locations, then the town is out $200.
Okay, you may want to take a look at 8-1-1 A and B, which I understand the concern. The first one says that if you've got a permanent place of business and you go to a swap meet, you don't have to get a new license if you're selling the same thing, but you have to notify the town of the location of the swap meet and maintain a copy of the license at your location at the swap meet. And the next one is a seasonal vendor operating at a swap meet who moves to a different swap meet is not required to obtain a separate license but shall notify the town of the new location. That is not what Shaleen is talking about. That is a change, and that's a change that was requested by the council, so we can change it back.
Yes, so I don't have a problem with them using one business license for multiple locations, but I think that we as a town need to know where those multiple locations are.
It does note that they shall notify the town of the new location.
But it's not a new location. For him, it's the same location every year. It's just that there's four of them in addition to his main location. His main location is a business on Main Street.
You understand that.
And then he has four different places that he goes throughout town to do vending every year.
So maybe the language says secondary locations instead of new.
Because it's not a new location.
We don't use the term new in here. It says the licensee shall notify the town of the location of the swap meet. This is that permanent vendor who goes and sells at a swap meet during the season. And it says the licensee shall notify the town of the swap meet, of the location of the swap meet, and maintain a copy of his license at the location of the swap meet.
So which one are you on?
I am on 8-1-1A.
goes to multiple oven locations, he has to, according to this, he has to tell us where all of those locations are.
But again, you're losing out $200 if he does not have to have a permit at each of those locations. Or maybe you want to limit it, I don't know, but the town could lose at least $10,000 from what I have gone through. There is one vendor at the RV show that if he only has to have one permit, he has 7 spots at the RV show, so.
Are they all selling the same thing?
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Shannon. On information required and the time limits of issuing a license in a timely manner, one thing that is missing here is if they know what zoning they're in. If they're trying to conduct a C2 business in a C1 zone or something like that, would highlight to the applicant at the time they're making their application that there's a problem. So.
That's why there's a zoning review.
That's why we.
Planning and zoning department.
This is information from the applicant, and they're not going to know what zone they're in.
I've never applied for a business license in an area that I didn't already know was correctly zoned. For that. Well, it seems to me.
I wish they were all like you.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Nancy Nichols, and I have a question regarding your zoning thing you're trying to do. My question is, what if you don't have a permanent place of business? For example, I have a business that's a landscaping business, and I also make jewelry and sell it at the powwow. So I have a business license, but my landscaping business is, my husband takes his tractor around town or around the county. So is a business like that, how can we be approved by planning and zoning? We have nothing to plan and zone. Just a question.
It could be your resident location or wherever you operate your business from.
I mean, it's our home.
Yeah, your tractor is out in the community, but you have to have a resident address or some business address, an address of record for the business.
Right.
Either that or an attorney that represents you.
Right. Well, I guess my question is wondering, I mean, the procedure for planning and zoning, I see if you have to put the paperwork and he checks off on it, but there's really no business to inspect if that's part of the requirement.
Yes.
So that's my question.
That's a description of the type of business that catch that brief description of the nature of business.
Okay.
That would highlight that it's a mobile business.
Okay.
Not subject to a particular zone.
Okay.
That would be the easiest one to check.
Yeah.
Right, right. Well, I just didn't want that to be a hitch if it was a, and I'm sure I'm not the only case of a portable business like that in town. And can I just also address a question that Shawnee brought up on the multiple thing?
Go ahead.
Or should I wait? Okay. Basically it's more of a comment that you have a business owner who has a permanent location, but yet he vends maybe in several places. Essentially, it's the same company. It's one company, even though he's vending in several areas. And her concern is that the town would possibly be losing money by eliminating him having to have a permit everywhere. Well, that may be, but maybe the town has been penalizing, I mean, overcharging all along. So we're trying to get it even. And in a sense, if you are requiring extra permits for extra businesses, you're kind of penalizing that business owner. He's out there trying to make more money because he's only in one single location and he's grasping for a few month window. I mean, you may not be getting so much in permit fees, but in his multiple locations, he's able to take in more sales tax. And I don't know if there's a way to check if the the $10,000 or whatever that she's suggesting you might lose.
That's that happy medium we're looking for.
Exactly.
What's fair to the vendor and fair for the town.
Right, so.
As long as that vendor reports their sales tax.
Well, yeah.
That's been a problem that we've had.
I recognize that, so. So that's just an observation more than anything. It doesn't affect me personally, I just.
That's, you said you go over to the powwow, you know, sell jewelry. You would have to have a vendor permit for that business because it's not the same as your trash business.
Well, and that is another question. I don't know if now's when to address that. I was gonna wait till you got to that, but. Yes, I do have a business license to operate in the town of Quartzsite.
For that tractor business?
Well, it's all the same business, NJN Enterprises. Whether I'm selling my jewelry, and the only place I sell my jewelry is the powwow. So that's always kind of been a question, and that comes up. I have a business, NJN Enterprises. We do a little bit of tractor landscaping, and then I make jewelry and I sell it at the powwow. The powwow is the only event. So I'm paying $75 for a business license, and then I'm paying $50 for a one-time permit to sell my jewelry at the powwow. And I just want to be clear on that, because through this whole process of, do I need both, or?
Well, that's something we need to address, because the way it's written now, you can only sell what that permit, or what that vendor permit has. If you've got one business, I don't know how we're going to address that. If you got one business that's an overriding enterprise, and you have multiple services or items out of that enterprise, how do we deal with that?
Right. Well, and because both businesses in my particular case are hobbies, so to speak. So, I mean, I don't know that you can really differentiate between somebody like Hardy's Beads and Jewelry has a stick-built business, or, you know, La Mesa RV or something.
I don't think a tractor landscaping business would be considered a crafting business.
No, but, well.
And that's part of the difference, too.
Right.
What you're doing with your beads and stuff is more crafting. You can make it yourself.
Right.
And that falls under the crafting.
But not a powwow. I have to have a permit, a $50 permit, to sell it at the powwow. So I'm not the only one in that situation. I know there are other people in town here who have a business of some sort, and they have a business license, but they vend at powwow just during powwow, and they have, in addition to their business license, they have to get the vendor permit. So I'm assuming you've kind of addressed that.
That's the reason we're here now.
Right.
Get rid of a cumbersome process,
right,
that was unfair to some of the vendors, sometimes unfair to the town. We're trying to make sense and get it sorted out, simplify it, make it affordable where we can attract more vendors, not chase them off.
Right, and that is very appreciated, to get it simple. If it has to be one or the other or both, that's great. Simplicity
okay.
is good,
let's,
thank you.
Just
out of curiosity, and you don't have to answer this if you don't want to, but you have your sales tax license is under the main business, correct?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Eric?
Yeah, I've got the same problem, times three. You know, permanent business, it's a mobile business, and we do one gold, the gold show every year, and we're having to pay each time for a business permit. The other problem is, I'm looking through this code so far, and everything says mobile food and sales of some sort, sales. Doesn't say anything about service, okay? I provide a service, my flooring service. I don't sell anything, okay? Now, there's all the RV repair guys out there, all the guys that are washing RVs, all those kind of services and everything. You have nothing that covers them at all. You got a mobile business, and over all the years I've been doing a mobile service thinking that was what we did. And in this thing, I didn't find anything that defines a mobile service. Okay?
Thank you. Susan, is there an area that addresses service?
No. Well, as to the mobile, I think he was looking at the mobile merchants ordinance, which is a little different, but the definition does.
He does carpet cleaning. That's a mobile.
I'm trying to figure out how that might be dealt with, but that's not what's intended by the mobile merchant's ordinance. That's the sale of things through food trucks or, I don't know, some other kind of widgets, carpets, stuffed toys that you see on the corner, that kind of thing. Well, not on the corner, stuffed toys, whatever you'd sell from a truck, basically. I hadn't really thought about that, but it's got to be addressed in codes, or I'm missing something. Just because you don't have a fixed address doesn't mean it's not possible to get a business license. So I might not be understanding the problem, because if you come in and you say, I want a business license, and it says, I want it, what's the address of your business? You say, it's not a fixed place. And I'm not identifying the problem yet. And you wouldn't need a TPT license anyway, because it's a service. So let me process this a little bit and see how it gets fixed in the business code. I'm not sure it's a problem.
When you have a service, you're selling your service.
It's a business activity that's subject to you have to get a business license. It's not the same thing. You don't have to have a TPT license because it's a sale of services. But I'm sure
it's a business, so why wouldn't you have to have a TPT?
Because it doesn't apply to services.
If you don't have a TPT, when he buys cleaning materials, he pays sales tax on the cleaning materials. He doesn't charge the customer he doesn't resell the cleaning materials.
Okay. So I'll sit here and try to figure out this multiple location of businesses somehow, but I'm sure it's easily fixed.
Well, I'd like to make just and it's just a suggestion when you can think about it. The state of Arizona, when they issue a license, a TPT license, and I know not everybody needs one, but when they issue a license, if you have multiple locations, they charge you a very minimal fee for each location. Courtside is $2. So if we did something like that for the people that had, this is just a suggestion, like the one that I was talking about that has the permanent structure on Main Street and goes out and vends in four or five different places, if we have a very minimal, like $2 fee for each of those other locations, that would be a way to help track those other locations for the vendor folks. Just a suggestion.
I like that suggestion too. Hi, my name is Mike Langsdenow. I'm going to represent the powwow. I've been handed the powwow, and we're kind of taking it over. Yes, we are. And so I'm representing about 250 vendors that come to the powwow. And unfortunately, we have a lot of overlap and an over expenditure that's passed on to our vendors who come from all parts of the world. We literally have lots of folks who come here. So now Joe and Sally come up and they say, well, I'd like to have three or four booths. And because of our limited capacity, we have no place to really put them. And so they tend to have to grab a spot over here in 201. And maybe they're in the 500 section. Maybe they're inside. Guess what? Now they got to have two or three vendor permits for each of those locations, all at the same cell unit, the powwow. And that's a concern that we have. I'd like to see if there's some way to resolve that, maybe with a minimal one-time fee, $50, and maybe a reduced fee for the additional locations. So at least we get the coverage we need, but not the total expense passed on to the vendors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
And anyone else before we turn the page? We spent most of an hour getting to this point. Is there anything on page 5, page 6?
Page 6, there's a couple of things.
Okay.
On C, the top paragraph, it talks about the swap meet owners shall make sure that all the vendors have a business license. But there's nothing that addresses what if they don't. What if they don't check them?
Talking about, well, then there's a penalty clause in the ordinance. And it's an enforcement issue.
Where is the penalty clause?
I'm not sure. You know, the penalty clause is one I sort of cut and pasted from the existing code. And you're asking a question about whether the swap meet owner isn't complying with that. I'm not 100% sure that it covers it, but that's where we would put it when we...
Okay, there's no reference to a penalty if they don't on that. C, on the swap meet owner is responsible to make sure all the vendors have a license. And and on E, and I'll go to the penalty part, on E, the same page, 6, it says the swap meet vendor structure shall be removed no later than 10 days after the season. It does not say all of their supplies and stock and merchandise have to be removed all either. So they tear down their tent and they leave a pile.
And while you're writing, if you would change in the letter D, the fine department to the fire department.
It's a very fine department, actually.
It is a very fine fire department, yes.
Okay, then on page 10 on the penalty for not getting a permit, it goes $50, $200, and then if you do it the third time, it says...
It's less than the second time.
$60. It should be $600, I do believe. And, well, 60 is a whole lot less than 200, which is your second penalty.
I think the penalty clause actually needs some work in general.
Okay. Anyone else on page 6? Page 7? Page 8? Page 9?
I did add, just now, in section 8-1-5, renewal of license. It says all renewals of licenses shall be subject to zoning review. I put by the planning and zoning department to make sure that was clear.
The only thing on page 8 that I would suggest is that on number 7, where we say the form I-9 with photograph, most people wouldn't know where to get a an I-9. It's a federal form. Mm-hmm. So if you tell them it's a federal form, they're more likely to be able to find it on a federal website.
And show I-95.
It's supposed to be an I-9, not a
95. So it should say federal form
I-9. That would help some people find it on a website, knowing it's a federal form.
Okay, that's that portion. Now, the rewrite and correction to that section, anyone got anything there that they need to address? Seems to me I found some words that were misspelled in one of these.
What do you mean, address the penalty portion that we need to do?
On the corrected one?
On 10.
Page, that's 10?
Page 10.
Yeah, the new section doesn't have page numbers, so it's kind of hard to match them up. And
just the last section numbers.
8-1-20. Okay, penalties?
Yes, and I certainly agree that the third offense should not be less than the second offense.
You know, I'm reading it, third offense, immediately obtain a business license at the escalated permit and a penalty fee of $60. So up above, the escalated permit fee under second offense is I don't understand it. I have to fix it. I mean, I just cut and pasted what's there.
Well, we don't define escalated permit fee. At least I can't define it.
We didn't. Now, to me, the escalated permit fee of $60 and penalty of $200 would be appropriate. I mean, And then the third offense, an escalated permit of $60 and a penalty fee of whatever, like more than $60.
I think it needs to be cleaned up.
Yeah.
And I'll bring it back. This is just, I'll come back with some ideas and work with Jim.
And then also on the fourth offense, instead of continuing the same track that they're not going to change their behavior, I think number two, B2, needs to come up to where number four is, where they're cited. Page 10. B2. Bring that up to where number A4 is. Instead of continuing the cycle of we charge you a little more and you pay a little more fee, but they haven't done it in the past, so why would they continue?
Okay, that section needs some rework on that. Move on to the next section, mobile merchant.
Before we do that, are we going to talk about calling out or putting some stipulations in, separate stipulations or procedures for seasonal?
Well,
is that something we want to do?
It's up to you. I did not, other than to make it a shorter time, but if you want to make it, how would you simplify the process for the seasonal vendors?
It would be the shorter time.
But that's in there.
Okay.
It's in 8-1-7B. And it's a lower.
No. The shorter time being the process for the town to issue the permit is what I think Shawnee was trying to get to. Is that correct, ma'am?
Yes.
Because I know, like at Powwow and at I think the big tent, somebody from the town goes and is actually on premise issuing those permits, the vendor permits, currently. So if we're changed, does that mean we're not going to do that anymore, that everyone will have to come into town hall and the people will go through permit, zoning, planning and zoning review?
It's a good point. Shawnee and I talked about it today, and that's the type of thing that's pretty unique, you know, to Quartzsite and the kind of vending that we have. We have to be out there in the field to require everybody to come into town hall. For those short-term events, we'd have to hire additional staff and build another counter, you know.
Well, if we're going to someplace like the Powwow or something like that, what would be the point of going through planning and zoning? Because those are some places that, and these people come in on Monday and they start vending on Tuesday or Wednesday. They don't have the time to come into town because they're on a rotation. They come in here on Monday, they vend until Sunday, they leave here on Sunday night, they go to Tucson on Monday. I mean, they don't have a lot of time to be here before the event to come in and go through this application through planning and zoning. But that's just the...
I think literally we need to take a look at that language in terms of the permanent versus the seasonal.
Now, for a lot of these fee licenses and permits, we have discussed putting it online where everything can be done remotely online. Is that available now where they can pre-register? Now, the Powwow, you have a show that's doing registering.
Yes.
Is it possible that they could have a system in place to do that registering?
So now you're asking, I think this is my again. Are you asking the Powwow, like my staff and myself, Sandy and my wife doing this task? We're already challenged enough as it is to get the information across to our senior folks, who many of them don't even have access to a computer, good use of computer access.
So now we're asking them to fill out a form, and we're hoping that Shawnee is gracious enough to come to the powwow for a couple of days and to try to get, push through hundreds of vendors, really, to get the application in the process of relearning everybody.
Would you have another term that we could use to identify that type of vendor versus seasonal? Because to me, seasonal could be somebody that's here from September to April, where the folks we're talking about are only here from Monday through Sunday.
Yeah, I like the word temporary, that's a good word. I mean, we're talking very, very short stay, many of them, like you say, they literally are here for just about 7 days, and we gotta re-educate them on the process, get them certified, make Shawnee happy, then she's got the resources, get all the documentation. And we're spinning our wheels, just remember, we're supposed to run the show. And so we're trying to educate everybody else in the same process, so it does make it a little more challenging for our staff.
Do your vendors pre-register with you?
Very few, literally when Shawnee would give us a pack, I think I remember maybe a pack of 10 or 12, a couple of times, and that was about it. Many of them, when's she gonna be here? And so we have to pre-book her for a couple of days, about 2 days before the show happens, so we can get all those permits processed.
The feedback from Big Ten, yes, the vendors were very happy that there was a table that they could go to, they didn't have to come here and deal with town hall. And it went really well.
Yeah, I don't wanna lose that, I think if anything, make Shawnee's process a little easier for her. I mean, in my mind, oh, computerize this whole thing, you know, type it up, print it up, whatever, but she can speak on that.
That was the intent to do just exactly that, and I think that that was just kind of a misunderstanding as we communicated to our attorney. That's an easy one for us to clean up. We'll talk about the language on that.
Could I ask a question, is the powwow more like a special event, or is it more like a swap meet?
Yeah, it's a special event swap meet.
One of the problems is when we have the powwow and Big Tent going at the same time, and Shawnee doesn't have a twin, we need to clone her. That becomes a problem. Quartzsite is very special, unique.
I'll work with Jim on how to try to address that.
I just wanted to let you know that the powwow, the RV show, and the Cellarama overlap somewhat. There were, at the powwow, about 262, I believe, vendor permits or vendors there. There were 436 at the RV show. How in the world would the town hall have every one of those people come up here and do a permit?
I think we all understand the problem there. We need to fix that. We got to continue with the approach that we've had to go out without question. We just need to take a look at the language. It's a process that Susan was not aware of.
I just have a quick comment that came up in as you guys are hashing this out. The question between a special event and a seasonal permit. It's $50 for a vendor permit, whether you're here from September through April or whatever the season is. And it's $50 for a vendor permit for 5 days at the powwow. And it's $50 for a vendor permit for 10 days at the Big Tent. I don't know if that's okay. And then I don't know if you still have the $15 3-day event permit. I don't know how many 3-day special events we have. So that just brings up the question that maybe things like the Big Tent, the powwow, the gold show, maybe those need to be recategorized under a special event because they're not really seasonal. Or is that too many? So just an observation again. Thank you.
Richard, go ahead. He's been.
Richard Trusty, vendor, business, et cetera, et cetera. I like the fact that they're special events because they are short term. Years ago, about 4 or 5 years ago, we did have a special event permit for the Gold Show. It was $15. Vendors didn't mind paying that. That breaks down to just a few dollars a day for them instead of $16 a day if they're paying the $50. And we could classify everything, say, under 10 to 12 days as a special event, because those people come into town, spend their 12 days or less, and leave. I do have some vendors that go from vendor space to vendor space, and they change their permits around. That's just what they do, and I've got some more coming up this week for the Gold Show. So I think a special event category, again, would be a nice category to have, and it leaves you some leeway. And the other thing I got a question with is, how can an event promoter be responsible for his vendors having permits? I don't get paid for that. I don't get paid to collect their taxes. That's not my job. My job is putting a venue together for them. So we need to look at that again, too. And those fines and penalties for not making sure your vendors have a permit is bogus. Thank you.
County fairs, a lot of times they're responsible for sales tax as well when they register. That's more every year, larger, longer events.
I guess something I kind of need to know, following up on that comment, the special event ordinance was not intended to cover these seasonal things or the powwow or anything like that. It was intended to cover large events that involve health and safety and a process for reviewing to make sure all of the resources are available. So we might want to cover what the problem is in a different way, but with the special events ordinance, which you're also going to talk about, was not intended to go this
different,
far.
Different name, not another special event.
If memory serves me right, the $3 event was for town-sponsored events for the vendors for the town-sponsored event. It wasn't meant for little things all over town.
That is true. That's the way it has been. Now we're broadening it a little bit in talking about all the special events, but we're still including the same kinds of things. We're not including the, you know, the swap meets or that within it. I think it's a duration issue that we're dealing with here, and I think that, as the mayor said, perhaps using a different term, considering the duration of some of these events, then we could probably fit that in.
And then we need to change the verbiage from what it is now to encompass the new way of thinking.
Okay, I want to make sure I follow what you just said. You're not talking about the special events category.
$3 or the $15. Special events, that's what it was for town sponsored events.
Right, that's the way it is.
That's the way it is now.
That's correct.
So it would have to be rewritten to encompass
it is.
The other.
Under the special events area, it is. It is rewritten.
Okay.
An easy way to deal with is I'm thinking about these seasonal vendors that, you know, here for the season, 180-day permit or license. And the short-term powwow thing could be as simple as putting a provision in there saying that for events less than X days, the town, I don't know if it's may or shall, but the town may establish a licensing desk booth, I don't know, at the event. And that's simple, and then the town that implements it in the best way possible.
And for that, the $15 thing would be appropriate.
It's just like we do with craft shows now. You know, we just would include them we wouldn't have to define them as a craft show. We'd just have an additional, and they're treated the same as a craft show.
May I ask Mike a question? When you guys bring in somebody to the powwow, do you not have some kind of registration with them?
Yeah. So currently our process for any vendor, the short-term temporary, I think is kind of the terminology I keep They come to our desk, and the first things we're asking for is simply a TBT. And then we have them fill out an application, at least if they've got us a business license within the state of Oregon, or excuse me, state of, wrong state, Arizona. Then we have an application process, but currently the application process is kind of weak, and we are looking at expanding that, so it will cover a little bit more details in relation to what they're bringing to sell for our programs.
Well, how difficult would it be to put on this application that you're doing, just a question, do you currently have a town of Portside business license? Yes or no? And then if they're no, then we can get Shawnee.
Well, here's the thing, is some of those licenses, they say, yes, I had it. Well, guess what? That expired 12/31 of the last year. So now we're having to reissue another one, so.
Thank you. Yes, I have to say that the QIA is fantastic. Before those people are allowed to sell, the QIA makes sure that they have a permit and a valid TPT number. So Sandy King, who has been in charge the last few years and now is taking over for her, they gave me a printout that of their registration, how they do it. First thing that's required is a TPT number, and we can now check those numbers ourselves. They won't tell us if they've applied for another one, but they will tell us if that number is valid. So, and we, what we've been finding, especially this year, in checking those, is that most of those TPT numbers are not issued with Portside listed as a sales tax beneficiary. So the sales tax, like if they applied for that number in Tucson, doesn't matter where they do business, they use that TPT number, the proceeds or the income goes to Tucson. It doesn't. So we are having many of these people apply again and pay $14, $12 to the state, an additional $2 so that Portside can be listed on their TPT number. But I am counted at least 40 of those that did not have Portside listed on their TPT.
So Tucson gets the tax when you get done.
Exactly.
See, when they apply for their TPT, if they would say Tucson, they get $2 to Tucson, if, and then they say Portside as another location, they pay another $2 for it. They can have as many of those locations as they want to on that TPT, but they are supposed to have every town that they go to that has a code. Every one of those is a different location, and they have to file TPT for each one of those locations. And Portside should be on there.
And if you weren't there questioning, those would just go right by the wayside, because that certainly is not QIA's responsibility to say, oh, you don't have Portside on here.
Right.
Thank you.
That's right. Bruce, that's the kind of things that they can look for.
I think it's kind of an answer, but I just want to, with QIA and the big tent, it shouldn't be your responsibility, I agree, to enforce, but I think there should be a responsibility to make sure that when they fill out the application, that they have evidence of a business license or a vendor permit. They should not be allowed to sell if they don't have a Portside vendor permit. And that's something that you can help us with. It sounds like you're doing that.
Yeah.
And that's great, because that was going to be my question. Well, yeah, you shouldn't be responsible for enforcing, but you should be responsible for making sure that they have a vendor permit, same with the big tent. And if we can facilitate that as a town, that we have somebody there, you know, with the permit or the vendor permit, then they, you know, it helps speed up the process, I think.
Well, I think that education and training is really the biggest thing, because right now we're all just trying to wrap our heads around it, trying to figure out, what do I tell my vendor who's coming from India, Pakistan, or all over the world, how to do this process?
Right.
And so we can simplify it, make everybody's job easier, then I can pass the word on, I can. Oh, look, I'm probably working on a website for Cal, so at least I can get the information out there so that these vendors vendors don't have to chase this stuff, but we don't have to remember it. It can just be a link to your page, order the stuff, and we're way ahead of the schedule.
Again, if we have somebody like you at the powwow, and you can check the list, make sure the court sign's on that list, that helps, excuse me, helps us immensely, plus it gets them their vendor permit right then and there.
And I also have communicated with the owners, managers of the other sites, and they are also willing to find a place on their application forms for the vendors to show the TPT number. So that will help too, that way we can check to see whether.
Are we having a problem with places like Tyson Wells and Prospectors Panorama and that with TPTs and vendor permits with those places?
Oh, not anymore at those two locations and at any of the others.
Or Rice Ranch or anything, you know. Yeah.
There's always some at every location that after 7 years say they don't know why they have to have a TPT number.
But those are bigger, longer term venues, exactly. And so, you know, that's where maybe our compliance officer can go by and check and make sure they have it. But for the quick ones like QIA and the Big Tent and those types of things.
Well, what they do at the QIA, I use them as an example for all of the other sites.
We appreciate that. But again, we're losing revenue. I never realized this about the TPT number.
A lot of revenue.
That's a lot of revenue. Yeah. Thank you.
To places like Tyson, right now, do we know if we have the same issue over there that they're using, that their TPT licenses or those vendors are issued elsewhere?
Yes. Anyone who brings their license, we can see on the license where their taxes are going.
And most of the...
But most of them just bring their TPT number with them and we validate it.
The validation doesn't tell you what the locations are.
Right.
No.
So...
That'd be maybe a requirement.
And well, this is something that I did ask the town manager was, after this season is over, if some representatives of the town could go and meet with them at the Arizona Department of Revenue and say, we need a list of the people that are listed, their numbers are listed for court set. So don't look at me.
I'd be happy to be one of those people as soon as it's not in January.
No, not in January.
No. Nobody goes anywhere.
Thank you.
Okay.
But Shani, if you were not, okay, most of the Tyson Wells, I'll use Tyson, or Desert Gardens, let's use Desert Gardens, most of those vendors come into Town Hall and get their licenses, correct?
No.
Or they're, no?
No.
You're going there?
I go there too.
And set up? Mm-hmm. So,
they're all very good about that, providing me a place to be at their location and my helper to be at their location. And in the 7 years, that I've been doing this and refined some of the processes, like the application form, which used to be four pages, is now one page, double-sided. But so they really appreciate having someone come there, and especially someone that can explain to them what the process is. And I have to say that this year I had only one person that gave me any problems.
Wow.
Well, that's
important. Well, I'm looking at the required information, and here E is Arizona Transaction Privilege Tax License Number. That's what we're talking about, the TPT. Right. So if they don't provide that, they can't get a license.
Exactly. We don't give them a permit until they have that or they apply for it right there with us.
Right. Okay. So
and that is another problem, is that there's only one place in town where they can get a money order. And that's the requirement here, is it has to be a check or a money order. But most of these vendors don't bring checkbooks with them. They bring their debit cards or their credit cards. And so then we have to go back to them after we've sent them to stand in line for a half an hour at the post office. I
used to sell money orders, but their system quit working and they haven't renewed it, so I don't know. But that is a definite problem in that we have to go back. But the only thing is that when we...
Post office does, the bank does, and Big Market.
The bank will only sell a money order if they have an account. If they have an account.
And Big Market doesn't?
They, Big Market.
They did it one time, didn't they?
Yeah.
Does he still, he didn't, when I was there checking a couple months ago, he wasn't doing money orders. So whether he is doing them again, I don't know. I haven't sent anyone there. But that is a problem, is that we can only accept a check or a money order for Arizona Department of Revenue. As well as the permits here out in the field, all we can accept are cash or a check.
We invested in some of the little cards that you put on your phone and...
Yeah, Square.
So we attempted to change that. Is that not correct?
I've never received one.
Really? Card reader?
Square.
Yeah.
Square.
You plug it to your device for the...
And it swipes card.
Or do you use credit or debit cards? Which seems like a big problem that has an easy solution. When some of the vendors have credit cards on their cell phone where they can process it, why don't they have equipment where we can do it? Speed that end up.
But we do require those who have an invalid number or no number to do an application for a DBT. And then we make sure the Quartzsite is listed on there, and we do ask them, is there somewhere else you're going to be vending? So that if they want to pay, and I did have a few that paid for extra places. Thank you.
Okay. Let's move on to page one, mobile merchants. That section is redlined. Turn to the tab definitions. On page one. Okay, let's go on to page two.
I have a question. Section 8-2-3, it should be unlawful for any person to operate a mobile food unit or act as a mobile food unit vendor without having first obtained a valid license from the state of Arizona Department of Health Services. Is this the same as a health permit?
Food handlers?
Food handlers?
Yes.
Well, the county of La Paz requires us to have their food handlers permit.
If I remember correctly, the state requires you to get a state license, and then you have to get the county food vendor's license. So we have two of them.
We need to check into that because, you know, we need to have the La Paz County food handlers also.
There are a couple of nationally recognized cards, food handlers cards, Safe Serve, and such.
But La Paz County doesn't necessarily recognize those.
That's
because
natural.
We try to have people, when we had our wagon at the church, they wouldn't recognize it. You had to have La Paz County.
They want you to pay for food handlers class and food handlers permit from La Paz County.
The state statute, as you know, that was adopted last year, may address this, and I need to look at that.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a comment on the food handlers. I have an Oregon food handlers card.
Uh-huh.
I go to them and give them that, and they hand me a permit. So I don't have to do it. They will accept it, but they may still. I still have to have the card.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Page page two, mobile merchants means any person who sells any type of tangible personal property, including but not limited to food and drink, at or adjacent to the person's mobile sales unit. That, half our vendors have an RV next to their booth, that we have a problem there.
I'm sorry, what section is that?
Page two.
Section.
Two dash two.
Under.
The definitions.
Four, all the way down, mobile merchant definition.
Paragraph six.
Okay, so, I'm sorry, so I missed your point.
I have a letter from Rain explaining her concern. And she states, the way this is, this ordinance is defined, it would include all our vendors with a mobile sales unit, which could actually be their RV, trailer, van, auto storage trailer, etc., if they park it on site. And she says, do you know how many vendors sell like this in town? Holy moly. She's saying that's half our vendors in town would qualify as a mobile.
Mobile merchant.
Yeah, so that's.
I think that's. I think that definition came out of this.
I think she's questioning the at or adjacent to the person's mobile sales unit.
I'm not sure I understand the question. I'm so sorry.
Is that a separate thing? Is an awful lot of our other vendors who do not necessarily drive around to different areas, they still have their mobile unit adjacent to where they vend. So.
And a lot of times they'll have inventory.
When this reads, they would qualify as a mobile merchant.
They'll keep their inventory.
What's the problem?
A vendor that has a location, has a easy up, a tent, whatever, if they park their mobile home, motor home next to it, and it has backup inventory in it, it becomes a mobile merchant by definition. That's what they're saying. They may already have a site permit for their regular vending site, but when this says at or adjacent to the person's mobile sales unit, are we saying they need two permits there? They've got a booth set up, but they park their motor home is right there at their booth, and they have backup inventory a lot of times in that. So is that a mobile? Are they required to get a mobile vendor's permit when they have a site permit already?
There's an example of a guy that has his van and his living quarters that is also part of his inventory next to where he has a tent with signs and flags.
Just out on the street, not part of a swap.
It's actually on it, pretty close to the street, but on private property. But it could be, the same kind of thing could be on a vendor lot. So they may rent two vendor lots. One would be for their RV, and the other one would be for the tent.
Okay, so how would you like to handle that? Because my recommendation is that you not be more restrictive than the model ordinance that was developed under this after the statute was adopted, but you'd be less restrictive.
If there's only one vending site, regardless of having a little backup inventory, if you're not vending from that RV, if it's just your easy up that you're vending from, then it would be one permit is what I believe it would be. But this could include the RV as a mobile merchant by definition, so add or adjacent persons. Well, what I'm saying is it should not, if they're not vending from both, regardless of even a little backup inventory. Right, and you could include half the vendors in town.
But the idea, and maybe the definition needs to be tweaked a little bit, because the idea is that you're moving, your food truck, was the model. That was the thing, that was the legislation, was about food trucks. And then when we were putting together the model ordinance, this little group of city attorneys and the league, we said, well, what if it's not just food? And so my recommendation to Jim was, you ought to cover everything. But the idea was that you're moving from place to place, not you're just parked in one place.
And that's the part that you can clarify here.
Yeah.
Mayor?
My two cents were, you're talking mobile food vendors and stuff like that. They all have to be on property that's already designated as a swap meet and or a vendor's space.
Not under statute.
We don't have any place in town. Where can you park a mobile food stand in town?
Right out in the parking lot.
Where?
In the parking lot.
Yeah.
You'd have to have a permit to be in that parking lot. You gotta get permission from somebody.
You should have to have a state permit, that's it.
You can pull in here with a mobile food vendor and vend.
The mobile merchant is intended to be for food vending, but by definition, it could also include your RV that's parked next to your Easy Up where you're vending.
I understand.
You could be required to buy a mobile merchant permit. And that's what I'm saying. We need to word this so that's excluded. If there's only one vending site, that would be all that would need a permit.
I could pull an RV into this town from the town parking lot and throw a table out and start selling rocks.
No, food.
Food only? Where's that rule?
Including but not limited to food and drink.
That has to do with the state of Arizona's new law.
Okay, this is a really good thing to talk about. Something I hadn't really anticipated. The legislation only applies to food trucks. But there were other kinds of mobile merchants other than food trucks. But the legislation only applies to food trucks. And it would require, as long as the mobile merchant was in a legal parking space, that you have to permit him, including a legal parking space out in your parking lot. But the way the ordinance is written, that applies not just to mobile food trucks, but to other mobile merchants. And you don't have to go that far.
Okay, but this says there's a section for mobile food unit, mobile food vendor, mobile merchant. Mobile food unit and mobile merchant is food and drink. So both of them are under...
My point is that you're in the definitions, but there are regulatory provisions which comply with state law, and the state law preempts you to a large extent, but the state law only applies to food trucks. We wrote this to apply to all mobile merchants, and maybe it went too far. Maybe you only do want to.
Just bring it back to food.
Well, a vendor's RV parked next to his Easy Up where he's vending needs to be excluded from mobile merchant.
That's what we're talking about. Yeah, we're going to try to deal with that.
That's our concern on this.
But the question raised was a good one. The statute would require you to permit a food truck in a legal parking space on your property. It doesn't require you to permit other kinds of mobile merchants. And maybe the ordinance goes too far.
It does. And that should include mobile sales units and so on.
Sales units, yes, that's correct.
Anything else on page two?
Sure.
So if we bring that back to mobile food trucks and the concern that the mayor brought out goes away, it would be helpful.
Page three.
Now, we still have to deal with services. How are we going to deal with services?
It's not related to this one. I was going to try to deal with it in the business license, mobile services. I don't think we want to get that mixed up in this because of the statute.
Page four.
Well, page three first. We have the issue on the fingerprint. There's just no way with a lot of our mobile businesses, food trucks, whatever, they come in, they're here for 1 day, 2 days. We need to get rid of that as a requirement. It's different if you've got a mobile business in town that's, you know, here for a long time, and that's the way they experience it.
Okay, that's number three.
So that's on page three.
Three.
So you're section 824, and then you're under C, 2 and 3.
Yep.
Fingerprint records.
Both of them are here and gone before the fingerprint.
Exactly. We wouldn't have the fingerprints back until they were here for the next show.
Yeah, and that was just an option that we put in.
And this would just apply to the
Food trucks.
Food trucks, short-term food trucks.
Well, all food trucks.
Okay, so the food trucks that, the food vendors, yeah. Like, we have two or three in town that are in, they're not trailers, but they're van.
They're on private property, and they're here usually here all year.
They would be required to do fingerprinting on those?
No, no fingerprint. We've taken out all the fingerprints.
Remove all fingerprints.
Well, yeah, it's included in the new section two that still says fingerprint records are required, so you're going to remove number two and number three.
And what about D?
C, 2 and 3.
D comes out also.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what you do with the information once you get it. We're not going to get it, so.
Okay, on to page four.
So does E come out too?
D.
E doesn't have anything to do with it.
Okay.
Oh, that's on the criminal history.
Page four.
Yeah, page four. We're taking D out about the criminal thing, but then the renewal applications.
But I don't see anything on E that ties it to our previous discussion about fingerprint surveillance.
Okay, page five.
I think some of these timeframes are a little long based on the mobility of these folks.
What section are you in?
Timeframes are section 8.2.4, letter G says time frame for issuance of licenses.
We can shorten them because those are restrictions on you.
Okay.
Oh, so no more than.
Yes.
Okay.
The Municipal Regulatory Bill of Rights requires you to have time frames for issuances of and licenses.
Anything else on five? Okay.
Four, it goes into criminal records for food vendors.
Under D?
F.
Under F?
F7. And then the next page, felony involving fraudulent dishonest acts. That's when they submit their application for a permit. That's a reason to not.
I'm sorry, you're under
page four, the bottom of page four, letter A.
Four. more on the top of five.
And in the top of five, letter B and C.
So, what's the question?
So, we were just talking about taking things out that have to be prepared in background check. I think she's pointing out that the section 7F7, continuing through subsections A and D of that, are similar in nature to what we were just talking about, background checks and fingerprinting and vetting in that way.
So you want to take out not just fingerprinting, but background check requirements?
I'm just asking because that's part of it. When they submit their application for a license, if that's part of the check and it comes back, they've got a felony or they're a predator or whatever, then that would be a reason for denial. I'm just asking about this section here.
Well, we have the same problem we're talking about with fingerprinting, et cetera. Any of those background checks take some time. And
if we remove fingerprints, how would we know about any felony convictions and any of these other things? So if we're taking out fingerprints, we probably need to remove the other requirements to go along with it.
I think you're probably right.
We have no way to verify it.
Anything related to that, where it goes away.
All that goes away?
Okay, on to six. A lot of sections struck out of that. Noise restrictions are struck. On to seven, security, anything on seven?
Yeah, when I went back and looked at your code, I saw you already had some. These were options that we put in, but you already have noise restrictions, so I incorporated those.
So on page 7, item number 4, F should be stricken. It says at least one person on site has been fingerprinted.
Well, I want to go back to page 6 and just note something for you. What we're talking about is section 826, and then subparagraph C. A mobile sales unit shall be inspected by the town's fire department, of course, as in our case, fire district, where the mobile merchant shall provide evidence that the mobile sales unit passed a fire inspection by another city or town fire department in this state within the preceding 12 months. We had an incident at our own Balconer day where if we did that, we've got a number of communities around here that do not really care if we have some of the equipment that the state fire marshal requires. May want to look at that one a little bit.
Well, that is a requirement in the statute.
Okay, so.
And it's a problem.
We have to accept where if another town, well. So then the state fire marshal's ruling is no longer valid because the legislature said we don't care.
And that's right out of the statute.
If we remove the sound noise restrictions from mobile food trucks, what about the ice cream trucks that drive through your neighborhood?
We didn't remove the noise. We just we redirected it to section 11.1-6.
Okay.
It's still in there.
But the fire department is inspecting the food booths, and I'm hearing some complaints about vendors are being warned about fire retardant structures when they have nothing to do around fires. So that's a confusing thing out there.
Well, that is being revisited by the fire district. They'll be looking at those businesses that are cooking, so it won't be applicable to all.
They've been applying them to all.
What's that?
They've been applying to all. Your tarp has to be fire retardant. And then if you, if you're cooking in it, then you have to have the fire suppressant, you know.
The suppress.
Equipment and.
See, that's the problem we have, is we have a number of other fire departments that don't require that. And they will give them a permit, and that means under the statutes now, if they got that permit and it doesn't have the answer system, we have to accept it.
Where does it say that?
Under the statute.
Under state law.
Under state law.
When we had our mobile kitchen every year, I had to have two things, pass fire inspection and have a county health permit.
The state law does not, requires you, the state law requires you to accept a fire inspection that was done by another city within the last 12 months.
In how many months?
12.
12.
So if they got by Parker, you.
Yep, that's correct. Parker issues a permit, they've done in the last 12 months, we have to accept it, is what it's saying. Now, that's a problem for our fire district to understand, but it applies to them just like it does us. The statute now overrules our ability to say, no, you have to have that ancil system in there.
Anything else on eight? Page nine? Page 10?
There is an option.
Like on eight?
Yeah, there's an option, I'm using the red line.
Eight?
Over on page eight, it's yellow highlighted. This is an option in the model ordinance, and it is a provision that sort of makes mobile food trucks mobile, keep moving. They can't stay in one place for, on private property for longer than 96 consecutive hours unless, the question is, do you want this?
No.
Well, that clears up a little bit that issue that the mayor was talking about, because now they have to be mobile.
Unless they have permission by the property owner, correct?
Notwithstanding the permission. We're saying that they're still gonna, this says that they.
They could.
Yeah.
Yes.
Shall not remain in one location on private property for longer than 96 consecutive hours.
But if they have permission of the person owning the property, they can stay.
Doesn't matter if they get permission, notwithstanding.
Well, you know, this is not required by state law, and you could strike unless the town, since it's the town grants permission for a permitted event greater than 4 days. And I think the idea was if there's an event, I'm actually not sure what the genesis of that unless part is, but it's the town that would grant the permission going beyond the 96 hours.
We have multiple mobile food vendors that are permanently located now. I can think of half a dozen different ones in town now, even though they're in a mobile unit, they're permanently parked. If we implemented 96 hours on that, we would force it to move, unless we find a way to license a mobile unit as a permanent business.
Well, fortunately, it just says it's optional.
Yeah, I think it would be a mistake to implement it.
Yeah.
If it's not a problem on the 96 hours, why would we even consider it?
Only if you want to ensure that if it's labeled as a mobile business, it keeps moving, you know? That's the only reason you can.
Have at least a half a dozen that are permanent in location, Patty's RV across the street.
It sounds like the yellow highlighted should come out.
Does this have anything to do with what we talked about, having like a van or a truck that had a sign on the side of it?
It can be a regular food truck, or we have one of them is a converted travel trailer.
We were, I think, at one point, under the sign ordinance or something, that if somebody had a sign on the side of a vehicle, that they could only be there for a certain period of time. I don't know, I'm just tossing this out, does this have anything to do with that also?
It's a separate issue.
Okay, I just wanted to ask.
Yeah.
A lot of the vendors that come in here are mobile in that they stay here for a length of time and then they go somewhere else, even if it's for the summer. So if you implement something like that, there's a lot of them that are not going to be able to, because they have to move every 4 days. Well, they'll just move on, is what they'll do.
I think that's intended for downtown areas where someone parks in a parking space in front of somebody's business and becomes a nuisance, taking up all the parking areas.
That's why the optional language is some towns might want that.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me make sure I understand. You've got, this only applies in commercial and industrial, because they're prohibited in residential except for ice cream sellers up above. So you've got a commercial strip center, and a mobile merchant can go and sit up there permanently?
In the vendor areas, we've got a lot of vendors. Every showground has at least one food vendor, you know, that's there for the whole season.
Does that fall under the, I think I took care of mobile merchants who are at swap meets, seasonal vendors, in the business license ordinance. But this is for the guy who's supposed to be, you know, mobile merchants, they run the roach coach, used to call them roach coaches, I guess, and now they have big events, but they're not intended to be there permanently. But do you care if a vendor in a truck or a food truck stays in a commercial strip center's parking lot forever?
With permission?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't it be up to the property owner?
I'm just asking because I want to make sure we're all on the same page.
Down on Kewin Road, Susan, we have it's commercial on both sides, and there are food vendors on both sides of the road, and they are there for at least 2 weeks to 4 months.
Okay.
And on Rice Ranch, there's a place there that they're around all the time, over and over by Coyote Fresh. There is a food vendor there.
Barbie's and Patty's RV across the street.
Yeah. Yeah. Will John's.
So the optional language.
Okay, so let me ask another question. It's probably pretty basic, because Jim and I made a decision, kind of, well, Jim made it early on, that mobile merchants, are now food trucks, would have to get a business license under 8-1. But we also, because we thought there were special circumstances perhaps applicable to food trucks or mobile require them to get a permit. Now that's also optional. It was an early decision and I don't think we ever revisited it, but you could just require a business license and not the permit also. It's an extra layer of permission. But maybe Quartzsite doesn't care, maybe the business license is all, and maybe I should let Jim address what he thinks would be appropriate.
Yeah, we're not dealing with food vendors on public right-of-ways. Within, you know, parking in the street, things like that. This is all on showgrounds or private property.
If it's an illegal parking place,
but the this does applies to the ones that are in a legal parking place.
Even if it's in a right of way, that's the preemption part.
So we could have a vendor rally, a food vendor rally, out here in the parking lot of Town Hall. And they could be there as long as they want, as long as they got a business license.
It just an event for the county, because we did talk with the county health department about doing a food truck, gathering type thing. And they would have to, the food trucks would have to comply with the county's permits, first of all.
No, the state oversteps the counties.
Right, well, now, yeah, but back then.
Yeah, but we're talking about now.
Yeah.
So how are we gonna cover it to keep the mobiles mobile and the ones that wanna stay be able to stay?
Business license for the ones that are permanent.
Well, places like, well, I would presume places like Barbie and, you know, Little John's, they have business licenses for year round. They're not vendors.
They're not really mobile either.
No.
Could that optional thing be applied on right-of-ways, but not have it private property? The ones on the showground, you don't want them to have to leave after 4 days. It would only be a problem if it was parked in a public right-of-way somewhere where we want to have that option.
The next section on parking, on page 8, right on page 9.
Page 9?
Why don't we work through that? The gist of the legislation is that food trucks get to go in legal parking places, but you can have some restrictions and regulations. So why don't we work through the parking section and then come back to that?
Yeah, you'll know in section 5 there, it talks about no more than 6 hours in a 24-hour period.
Did you have something to say?
Yes, thank you. I'm confused. We've not been selling business licenses to those food vendors at the vending locations. All we've been doing is a permit. Were they supposed to have both a business license and a permit?
No, that's not current. That's what we were looking at. It's a whole different thing.
Okay.
You've been doing it correct.
Okay.
And I think as we look at the trend and what we're trying to do with some of the rest of this, the probably needing both is unnecessary.
Just go to the business license, but they have to comply with these regulations. I think so too.
That fits better with the rest of what we're doing.
Okay. Are we back on the weapon here?
Yeah. Well, we went past that and then we backed up.
Yeah, these are where some of the questions have come up.
Okay, back on 9.
And these, I don't think any of these, other than they get a right to park in a legal parking space as a general rule, I don't think any of these are driven by state law, as I recall.
Okay, these are all dealing with the food vendors that are mobile, not like over at Tyson where the food vendors are off the street, facing the street, open windows.
Primarily roach coaches and slices, they fight.
I'm not sure I really thought about food trucks or roach coaches being a permanent thing, so I might have to reread this whole thing. if that's what you want to permit,
yeah,
that's
permanent
not...
Permanent here is typically seasonal permanent. It's not like all year-round kind of thing. It'll last from October to April, maybe.
Barbies and Patties are year-round.
There are a few.
Several
of them. But most of them come in for the season and then they leave.
And number four, no mobile sales unit shall operate with a serving window facing the street traffic. There are some that we have in town that are facing and back off, so that's probably where we need to notify the showground owners to not allow people to park with their serving window facing the street.
Well, that's a safety thing, I would think.
Yeah, but I mean, there are some over there, like a Tyson, if they live facing one.
Yeah, but that's, wouldn't that be for if they're parked on the right of way or near traffic rather than?
And to say here, no mobile sales unit shall operate with a serving window facing the street traffic?
I think that needs to be clarified in terms of setbacks.
In context.
From the street and from the right of way.
In context is when they're talking about parking spaces along the street.
We have a unique situation on parking spaces.
Why doesn't that surprise you?
You don't come out here in the daylight, you can't get around.
I drove around, I got out here early today and I drove around trying.
Difference between the road and the sidewalk and it's all dirt.
We want to hear from me before now. We want to hear during
So going back to what Pastor Bruce was talking about earlier, on J, on the same page 9, signs, a mobile merchant shall comply with the town sign code. And he had brought up earlier if this overlaps in any way with the sign codes of having business sign in a parking lot on the side of a vehicle.
Right, it still has to comply. I mean,
But I don't think we made those prohibitions. We talked about them. I'd have to go back and look to see what we did, but.
That's what I couldn't remember. Did we decide on that?
I'll go back and look. I don't recall that being a restriction anymore, but I'll check on that.
Okay.
I know we talked about that quite heavily.
Yeah, the sign ordinance problem was taking an unusable, inoperable vehicle, putting a sign on it, parking it out in a lot somewhere off the road.
I don't think this.
Okay. 10. Anything on 10? Anything on 11? Number 12, there's no changes on that. So we are done with mobile merchants section. Okay, let's move on to tab 3.
There's minor redlining from the discussion at the last meeting.
This is a special events ordinance.
There's a few things in here.
And again, this is for helping. This has been kicked around for about 4 years now, and it's now just reaching you. But it's to address health and safety issues related to large events that involve invitations to the public where probably they need some regulation.
On page 2 definitions, I see that we added E, F, and G finally to the definition in the new section, so G, H, and I. So definitions includes all of those and this under special events now.
Okay, I have one question on the special events to out the gate. How does the Quartzsite Special Events Inc. get involved in this?
It does not. It doesn't mean that a special event that would be like a town special event That is a fundraising accountability nonprofit, yeah.
And are they subject to the same rules as special events?
If they're holding a special event, yes.
Okay, page three. This was the section that we questioned once before on, I think it was C, when applicable, some of these may not require TPT license. It's saying that it's required on all of them.
I'm sorry, where are you looking at?
C, page three, under C.
And we go back to two.
And that's in the last one, has it been corrected? Page three on C, in the new version and the old one, it's still saying the applicant shall obtain a transaction privilege license. And Loretta had asked before about if applicable or if required, and I don't see that.
Unless you're selling some kind of product, there is no sale.
Like if it's a race car.
There is a TPT code for entertainment, but that typically has to do with music and the kind of things that Rock Fiesta did. But in here, this is saying that you won't get the permit unless you are agreeing to report and pay all taxes. But like, for instance, Portside Special Events, they promoted the event, but they didn't sell anything. Anything that was sold there was by the individual vendors who are responsible.
I will make that all subject to
Festival, musical concert, parade, public assembly, sporting event, all of those could be where there's nothing sellable for TPT. So if we included when applicable, the applicant shall obtain a transaction privilege license, something to that word.
Okay, we have races and competitions that aren't in the definitions under special events.
Sporting events.
That's just sporting events, but races and competitions.
Yeah, it's races
under G,
yeah, sporting event. Last word, golf and races.
Okay, golf and races, but that doesn't include competitions.
What other kinds of competitions?
G states competition and race.
It says it means a competition or activity involving.
We have ATV races, and they have prize money and trophies, and
it's clearly covered under this.
It's clearly covered. Okay. And should we charge a fee for alcohol per day for special events? You have a beer garden, should they pay a fee per day for the garden?
I don't think I addressed that. Do you want to add that?
There's other towns that do, and that's why I'm asking. Problem of indoor-outdoor activities under, is it a special event indoors, but they're doing the same things outdoors?
All outdoor activities.
Only outdoor.
Indoors are covered by building codes. See, what the problem with special events is usually their size, but also they're outside, and so there's no safety regulations. But if they're inside a building,
fourth. Anything went on the fourth? Okay, on the five, I have a problem with special events, 22-2-3A. Second, third line up from the bottom, town manager may require a greater deposit if he, should be she, they, something that's not gender specific. And in B, where it says schedules, should be scheduled, past tense.
Could I go back to your code on your first question? Under section 1-3-8, and we have, we're trying to make the code kind of consistent and not just have he or she or he and she in one section on others. But your code section 1-3-8 says words of a masculine gender include the feminine. That's how it's just.
Okay, is that going to be consistent? Schedules should be scheduled. Okay. Page six. Anything?
Let's see. Under A, we're asking for a minimum of 2 off-duty sworn public safety officers, priority to Courtside PD, but we're not saying that the event is required to pay for those off-duty or those security people.
It says it, I gathered it, I put a provision in that all costs, hang on, we go to section 22-3-12, because I would have had to put that in every single section.
Okay.
So I just said all costs associated with the special event should be the responsibility.
We called it out in one place, that's why I got that related to.
I think also an issuance of permit under section 22-6-4, under A8, the applicant has secured the police protection of any required by the town manager. So it sounds like we are making it clearly that it is the applicant that is responsible for procuring that.
Right, but I'll go back and check to see if it's called out specifically in the section. I think that would create some confusion. I'll just leave it as a general rule.
Okay. Six, we're done. On seven.
On seven, on noise, 22-3-3, it says amplified music. I believe it should say sound. Because if you have races, if I want to have a drag race down Main Street, it's going to be loud. The ATV races are loud, so I think the noise level shouldn't be specific to amplified noise. It could be a crowd that's cheering for something that could be outside the decibel level.
Yeah, now further down it says sound level shall not exceed 100 decibels.
But it says if amplified music is used, and so you've got sound level and amplified music. So to be consistent, it should just say sound.
Suppose that it's a loud speaker turned up so high.
That's the amplified music part.
Well, music is anything with.
Might be a political rally with no music.
Well, and if it's like was brought up, some kind of event like a drag race, they wouldn't fit the cars
some indication for amplified music, because you can measure the dB level of music, but you're not going to be able necessarily be able to measure the sound of a dragster until that dragster is going down the road. But here, you can measure before the event even takes place, the sound of the music.
Do you want to try, if you're going to approve a race, are you going to try to regulate sound level?
It would be too difficult, I think.
So that's not in there.
Right.
Well, I think.
But you can regulate the decibel level of amplified sound, of amplified music, or somebody speaking very loudly. Anything that's used that amplifies the sound, you can regulate that.
So instead of saying amplified music, just amplified sound?
That would be better.
Probably would be better.
Artificially amplified sound?
Amplified music or sound, something.
I think you just put.
Inclusive.
I think you just put amplified sound, because that is the implication that you're going to have, speakers, microphones, and amplifiers, and all that stuff. And then you're going to measure it, having your amp, a dB meter there.
Yeah.
And so somebody from the town that knows how to use a dB meter is going to have to be there to measure. Now, you also have to take into consideration that the more people you have there, the more bodies you have there, that dB level could go down because it's going to be absorbed by other people.
The Rock Fest, I used a, granted it wasn't a calibrated dB meter, but at the speaker, it was 85 dB. And they guaranteed that at the perimeter of the festival, it would be no more than 54. And I went to the perimeter while it was rocking, and they kept it, so it did not go 54 dB at the perimeter. And so sound is a very interesting critter. Bruce's Church, they have reasonable decibels inside the building. Yet the building itself acts like a speaker that amplifies certain frequencies. So there's a lot of variables with sound.
Well, that's why the 58 decibels measure at the near.
That's a reasonable level.
Should we just delete, because frankly this was more of an urban area that I took this from, but should we delete the reference to 100 dB at the house mix position and just leave it at the, if residential property lines are probably the thing that.
Well, see, the problem with that is, where is the house mix position?
That's why I was saying, should we take it out?
Because some people like to be right in the middle of the crowd. Some prefer to be way back. And so I don't know if that 100 dB at the house mix position.
Oh, I think that's at like where the speakers are.
Yeah. I don't think that's
not really
an accurate thing to say.
So why don't we take that show mics, exceed, and then just skip to 58?
The important thing would be the 58 dB measured at the nearest residential property line or event line.
Because the residential level is where you're going to.
If somebody wants to stand in front of amplified speakers and ruin their eardrums, that's up to them. We can't control that anyway, but we certainly can control the atmospheric sound coming that would infringe upon somebody else. And that's a reasonable thing to do.
With Bruce speaking, we had 64 dB in our system here in the building. With Bruce speaking,
we had
64 dB decibel level in our building at my seat. And
so really
those
the property
are
line
looking at us.
Property line.
So in B.
So B, then that first sentence should be struck.
The whole thing is dealing with the house mix position.
I think that where it says the town manager may have a consultation with a noise or sound professional, modify the maximum sound. except that that 58 dB measure that mirrors residential property line, that still needs to be in there.
Don't you have that on the NA?
Pardon me?
Isn't that on the NA?
Yeah, but the applicant may request.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
The applicant may request a higher dB sound level, doesn't mean he won't get it, but he can request a higher level at the property line. And that's where we would have somebody that's an expert come in and measure that.
100 dB is just about like a jet engine. They're 100, 110, I believe.
How do you know all this?
Because I'm stupid.
And again, I think that last time, the required measures, the adjusted sound level, maximum sound level, again, take out the house mix position and put in there the property line or whatever it is.
Okay, we're ready to go on the toilet facility?
Yes, we are.
One into the other.
I do like the ADA accessibility guidelines added into this.
Okay, we're on eight now. Anything else on eight? On the nine?
Jim, it's 15 days before to get our council agenda enough.
You on eight still?
Yeah, down on street closures. Down on street closures, it says 15 days prior to a special event in order to get it sufficient for an agenda.
No.
I don't even think so.
Yeah, it is.
So should we make it 30 days?
I thought we did change that.
Well, it says 15, I did.
Well, and 30 might be a little tough on, but I think we need at least 20 to make it work.
Just one thing, looking at the solid waste disposal, there's nothing in here about the duration of letting that waste pile up before the honey wagon comes and empties the porta potty. I mean, should they have to be a daily inspection or every 2 days or whatever? Because also always deliver samples, multiple days, the ground should be maintained during that. There's no specification as to how often.
Well, it says they're going to include a plan, okay, for the collection disposal, which, you know, that'd be part of the plan. How often are you going to have those? Just inspect it or anything.
Okay, I just want to make sure, because if they could keep that, I think we had that about Connors, I don't know how often those were emptied, but we have more people than expected. We have to be able, there should be something there that maybe in case of an emergency, contact the company to empty the toilets.
Wouldn't that go under toilet facilities?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were solid waste.
That's right.
Okay.
Solid waste is a toilet.
In the handout that y'all got, there's a under Lake Havasu restroom facilities calculation chart of how many porta potties per how many people, and it lays it out real well.
Yeah, and I saw some of that. I think that's part of the application process, kinds of things that we want to consider.
Okay, are we on to nine now? Anything on nine?
Well, this is the spot where I was talking about the use of alcohol. Would this be where we would impose a permit or an amount for use of alcohol? Like,
we could have a section there. We're going to look into what some of these other communities are doing. Lake Havasu, et cetera.
offset the extra police and so on that have to be out there when they've completed their drinking.
I also see the same issue with the, yeah, the 15 days prior to getting on the council, maybe that 20 days.
Make sure it's on the agenda. Now, of course, if they're smart, though, because they still have to get it to the state, you know, so.
Now, vendors, says that applicant shall provide a list of vendors to the town manager at least 7 days prior to the special event. We didn't know who all the vendors was going to be in about Congress 7 days ahead of the event. A lot of vendors don't show up till right at the last. One showed up the day of the event.
You're correct.
So.
And that could come out.
Well, it needs to be a lot less than 7 days, or could be down to clear the day of the event if they show up and we have space for them.
I think as long as we follow our permitting process, it's probably not even necessary to have it in there.
Yeah, and why would the town manager need to know that in advance?
So we know which vendors, well, not the town manager particularly, but the town needs to know, so we know which vendors that we need to look. I think we should get a list. And as soon as possible. I think 7 days is maybe a little out, but we need to be able to coordinate and make sure all those vendors are properly permitted.
Some of these events don't start till Saturday, and if they show up on Saturday, nobody's going to be open to give them a permit unless they're sold at the event.
And maybe the person that's putting on the event should be required to submit a list by the end of the event.
So then we won't permit for someone to permit after the event?
Why not?
We could use the same approach that we use at Shawnee. We just have somebody on site that's capable of permitting.
On a weekend?
Well, it's a cost. If they want to have that opportunity, they pay for having somebody out there.
Does that need to be in the ordinance? In this, let's say if you have an event on a weekend and it requires special handling, you'll be assessed a certain fee for that?
We want to do that. We want to give them notice that if you, I'd like to work on that language, but.
Including 7 days is not workable.
No, I'd agree with you on that.
And like on the cemetery board, if you have an opening and closing on the Saturday, there's an extra fee for you.
Right.
Do that. I think that if they're going to have an event Saturday, Sunday, Monday, doesn't give us an opportunity for them to come in Friday to get their permit, then I think we had to have some kind of language in there saying that if you're having this event where town offices are closed or whatever, that you have to make arrangements and there'll be an extra fee for that.
So each vendor has to have a business license. And I was working on some language for on-site applications and licenses.
Mm-hmm. That's what we're going to have to do.
Okay, anything else on 9?
The only comment on the responsible for cost, I think we ought to give them an example or two, like such as security or, maybe even this vendor permits. Just give them an example of what the extra cost would, for their cost would be. Just a thought. Not excluding other things, but just.
And the inspection, re-inspection should be able to be done on the weekend also.
Which one?
Inspections or re-inspections?
Uh-huh. I was just looking at that, thinking the same thing.
Right above the applicant's clause 22.311.
And where does it say?
Okay.
Oh, you want them not to have to, okay.
In other words, if they need an inspection on the weekend, then they need to pay a fee and have it done.
And in their.
Anything outside of normal town business hours?
Okay. Are we done with that?
No, wrong address. If the wrong address, I think that town should keep track of the wrong addresses, and when those people come back to get a permit again, unless they give you a correct address, they don't get a permit.
Okay, let me recognize that.
I just have a suggestion on your special events where you require a permit fee or an inspection fee in addition to the application fee, for instance, the Buck Connors days. You charged a $15 special event fee, or however you want to terminology, and then you charge, say, $25 or whatever it was for the vendor booth. To accommodate the people that show up Saturday morning to set up, why don't you just include that fee automatically, and it's collected at that time, whether it's Friday night or Saturday morning or Sunday morning, and then you may not have all the T's crossed and the I's dotted, but you've got your money.
The late show-up fee?
Well, you have an event and you charge $40. $15 of that is the special permit, and then the rest goes to the promoter or whoever needs to collect the fee. If you know you're going to have extra costs, such as extra security, just include that up front in your original fee, and that will accommodate anybody that shows up last minute. That'll accommodate those people that show up Friday night after your offices are closed, rather than add extra staff to take care of it over the weekend. Just throw the fee in there right up front.
This is not for the vendors to pay. My impression is it's for the promoter to pay. In other words, if it's going to require a city employee, a town employee, to be there on a Saturday, that's an expense that the vendor, that the promoter has to pay.
Right.
It's not for you as a vendor to pay.
Right. I'm just saying that include that fee up front.
But we don't want you to pay it as a vendor. We don't want you to pay it. We want the promoter to pay it.
Right. But I mean, if you.
So if I come in and I'm going to have a swap meet, and it's going to be Saturday, Sunday, Monday.
No, that's not a special event.
I know, but I'm just saying, as a special event, I'm going to have it Saturday, Sunday, Monday. I, as the promoter, will have the understanding that the town is going to charge X amount of dollars to have somebody from the town make sure that everybody has their permits. That's not something you're going to pay.
Right. No, I get that. I'm referring to what you mentioned about people that show up Saturday morning, like at Buck Connors Day. You know you're going to charge them a fee, but you don't have any town people to facilitate that or document it at that time or collect it. So rather than have your staff, who typically works Monday through Friday, just include that fee up front rather than have to have somebody collect it. I don't know. I'm getting off track here.
And that, again, I don't see that that's the responsibility of the vendors to pay. It's the responsibility of the promoter to make sure that there's somebody there. If you as a vendor, if you're going to come in and you understand that you're only going to come in on Saturday, and you're not going to be here Friday, and the promoter says, okay, you can come in. To me, it's the responsibility of the promoter to make sure that there's somebody there to collect the application, the vendor fee.
And actually, for Buck Connors, we did include, we charged $45, and so we included the special event vendor fee. Was included in the cost, the vendor space and the permit.
What you're suggesting, what you're suggesting in terms of the vendors that may come in at the last moment is exactly what we did.
Basically. Right.
That is what we did.
Well, I guess I was just going on the idea that you needed to have somebody that typically doesn't work Saturday there on a Saturday to do inspections or.
Well, but that's. That falls in a different category now. Okay. This is not for the vendors, that's for the promoter, okay? Because there could be certain inspections that may have to occur there, you know.
Okay.
That doesn't involve a vendor. It involves a promoter that's putting it on.
Right. No, I was just thinking of a way to make it easier for you guys and not have to add extra costs, not, it wouldn't affect the vendors, I get that.
This doesn't affect the vendors.
Right, I get that.
Okay, is that the last on nine? Number 10? Anyone have anything on 10? 10? Going once, going twice? 11? 12?
I'm just pulling back on 11 and the fees and stuff. Is that going to be, are we going to put in like usual and customary, or how are the fees going to be determined? There's the mention of fee into a contract to pay for the town resources that would be used. And we had the grader and stuff that was used for the motorcycle thing. How is that going to be determined?
The town manager will have to, that's a good question. It's not a standard fee, but I don't like usual and ordinary. The town manager should be looking at, you know, two security police, off-duty police officers or three.
But like we had, they wanted to use what was it, water truck they wanted to use and the.
Right, we have a schedule that we use right now. So I understand what you're saying is perhaps we should have some language in there that has to do with the scheduled fees structure.
But not all of them, but do you have fees? Do you have a fee schedule for off-duty police officers?
We do.
Like we have like water truckers, a certain amount.
Correct, and we had a certain amount for the equipment, a certain amount for the operator.
Right.
And it's a fee structure that we use essentially for anybody that would have used that equipment.
Maybe something in there based on the town's fee structure or something like that.
Okay, we done with 11? On 12? Anything on 12? Seeing none, 13? Nothing on 13? On the 14?
This thing mentions the animals and parades. Do we have anything in here? Because I didn't see it, that who's responsible for cleaning up after the animals?
I don't know.
I thought that was in.
That's definitely in there. I did, I read it like 5 minutes ago.
That is sanitation of the facilities, but that's not. Adequate sanitation, another, I'll make sure that cleaning up after the animals.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Cleanup fees, even after a parade, can be more than just animals.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Anybody been to New Orleans after?
Exactly.
I think the only place that I see animals addressed is 22-6-6A5. It shall be unlawful for any person to ride, drive, or cause to be ridden or driven any animal or any animal-drawn vehicle upon any public street unless specifically authorized by the permit. But that talks about riding, driving, causing to be ridden, not specifically someone walking through with their herd of goats that they wanted to show.
Yeah.
15, are we okay with 15? On 16?
On 15?
It shall be unlawful that for any person to ride, drive, or cause to be ridden.
Yeah, does that mean a camel can't be here?
I don't ride.
No, it just says you have to have a permit.
This is ridden or driven.
Unless you have a permit, so just that part.
So we have to have a permit for the camel?
Yeah.
If it's in a parade.
If it's in the parade.
All right, now, if we're gonna have a horse wagon or something like that, we have to have a permit for each horse wagon.
If it's in the parade.
I don't see it as a separate permit for each one, but they have to be listed on the permit. That you're gonna have a camel, that you're gonna have a horse lawn carriage.
That way we know if there's animals, you know, specifically.
So would you wanna know how many animals are in the parade?
Well, the event has to be permitted.
If a kid showed up with a wagon with a dog on it, it'd be the same thing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Gotta get this straight.
Yeah, oh, thank you, Brad.
Thank you.
Okay, on 16. Anything on 16? 16, go ahead. On the 17.
One thing, overall, I did not see anything about real, and maybe I just missed cleanup of the grounds and so forth, if they're, like, at the park or wherever they are, that I don't see anything, I didn't see anything in here that said that they are responsible for paying for cleanup.
Person maintaining the special permit, special event.
Statement that Susan made that at all costs.
Yeah, but the cleanup, it doesn't specifically say they are responsible for the cleanup. That's solid waste. I'm talking about trash.
Restoring the property to.
We need to have them get that part back where it was when they walked in.
So if we have, in that case, it wouldn't be a parade, it'd be a public assembly. The reason parades and public assemblies are kind of called out separately is that there's certain First Amendment rights that go along with them, as well as they need to be large events.
Well, like about Connors, for instance, when we set up all of those temporary.
That's not, that's, that would be a special event.
That's what this is.
As opposed, well. Let me go back and look at how we treat cleanup of, because I'm on the special, I'm on the parades and public assembly section.
No, I was just talking, going back in general, overall, it was one thing I did not see in here, was that we were requiring them to clean up and bring the property back to where they found it.
Say if somebody, if we permit them to have something in the park, okay, there's a certain condition that the park is in, they must return it at their expense.
It's here.
To them, it must be the town manager's approval.
Page 5A is listed. 5A, town property, including town facilities used for special events, shall be restored to their original condition, including but not limited to removal of debris and waste. Town manager may require a greater deposit if he determines.
What page was that on?
Five A.
Thank you.
Okay.
Another, just overall, if we get a lot of special events, that's all we're gonna be doing.
I was just counting these up, I was thinking, you know.
Could we not say town manager or?
Or the designated.
Yeah.
It does say that in the beginning.
I think it does, right, yeah.
It doesn't.
I hope that we need an entirely new position.
It doesn't say that everywhere, but it does say it at the very beginning.
Oh, yeah.
And it also says that in 1-3-2, your general section, when an action is done by somebody, it could be his authorized.
Every time I saw town manager.
When are you getting your assistant?
Well, I saw the duly authorized.
Okay, any last comments?
Are we moving in the right direction? Are we making headway?
If I could understand a lot of it, it would. We never touched on nonprofits.
They were listed, they were in here.
Okay, I don't have it in here. And I didn't hear anything about them tonight, so I was just questioning that.
I would have raised it had it not been there, but nonprofits are listed.
Pardon?
Nonprofits are mentioned in here.
Okay, so what are we doing with the nonprofits now then? How's that for a question?
Okay, where is it? It's under fees and other things, I remember reading.
Permits or?
It's under the permits.
And what reference for nonprofits are you?
Well, I've got a number of nonprofits that are gonna be attending my show. And I'm trying to find out if they have to have the permits. For sure, all I need is a yes or no answer. And how that's going to apply to them at that point. I mean, I've got the Girl Scouts, I've got the 4-H, I've got the Quartzsite Metal Detector Club, I've got the Quartzsite Rock Gem and Mineral Club, I've got, two chapters of GPAA that are coming in. A lot of them don't sell anything at the show. They're just there to be there to the show for demonstrations.
Dude, one of our churches gives away water, doesn't sell anything, and they're required to buy a $50 permit. This year, we're in the process of updating all that, but last I heard, this year they were to pay the original.
Okay, so they're gonna pay this year?
Last year, but not next year.
Okay, so I can give them some good news then?
Yeah, but let's confirm it with Jim.
Well, we may have to look at that, because what I'm reading here, on, in the first one that we went over,
No, that was previous page.
On page three, talks about exemptions.
Yes.
And that's talking really about a license should not be required when religious institutions engage solely as a place of worship. So really that doesn't, we're not.
No, these are just nonprofit 501(c)(3), whatever.
501(c). There was something in here about 501(c)s, and I can't find it right now, but I don't remember seeing anything in there for nonprofits to.
Okay, well, I gave Jim the list the other day, and I've invited the town to be out there on Thursday afternoon to start checking the permits. And I just was hoping I could give the guys some good word for next year if we're gonna do it again next year.
What he's asking is, people like the Girl Scouts, the Boy Scouts, a church, a nonprofit organization, if they're going to participate in an event in town, are they required to have a permit, a vendor's permit, or in business license, right?
They've all got business licenses already.
Right.
So what's the question? They have business licenses.
They have a business license.
So what are you asking?
They're going to attend a show. They're going to set up and say, hey, we're the Rock Gem and Mineral Club. This is what we do in our club. Here's our club over here across the street. Come and join us someday. They're not selling a product. They're there for information only. This is I'm trying to do an educational program with kids and families and Quartzsite people. Yes, I'm asking if they need a business license. Most of them aren't required to have a TPT already.
If they're there to give out information, or they're not carrying on a business in the town, so I'm having a hard time.
Well, okay, let's just call it a vendor permit then. Are they required to have a vendor permit?
The vendor permit is subsumed under the business license, and there's different kinds of business licenses. One is for anyone who's carrying on a business.
They're here to do a show.
But they're not selling a product.
That's my point. Are they carrying on a business?
They're promoting their...
Their business. That's all they're doing is promoting their business. They don't even have a product to sell.
One of them gives away free water at the vendor shows. I think when we discussed this last time, it was this year they need to pay that $50 permit. Next year... we're doing away with it. Is that correct?
We discussed the possibility of doing away with it. That's correct.
Yeah. Well, again, what's
but it does not appear that we've addressed that clearly here.
Well, according to what's written here, again, it says exemptions, license required, okay, which would be a business permit, right?
Business license.
Business license, okay. It says, a license shall not be required when, and one of the things is religious institutions engage solely as a place of worship. That's not what he's asking about. But he's asking about if the Girl Scouts go to the QIA and they want to hand out literature about the Girl Scouts. Right, so they don't need a permit. However, if they're selling Girl Scout cookies, do they need to have?
Is it a casual activity? It might be.
And it's a nonprofit organization.
Yeah, the key to it is they're all nonprofits.
Right.
And that's where I've gone to the state, and the state says, no, they don't need TPTs. Well, you gotta have a TPT to get a business license or a vendor license in Quartzsite. If the state doesn't require a TPT, how can you get one?
I think Susan was saying, if it's a casual thing instead of ongoing.
It's 3 days out of a year.
Okay, definition, is that casual?
Let's take a look at the issue and.
Okay, well, are we gonna have another meeting like this, coming up shortly? Okay, because it's gonna be too late to do anything about the show this year. I've told most of them they're gonna have to bite the bullet and pay out money.
Well, I think we made it very clear previously.
Right.
This year's rules. Starting in the new year is when this will be applicable.
Okay, that's what I need.
And I understand your issue, so I'll.
But I just wanted to make sure that they were on the record here. We're gonna be working on that in the next meeting evidently to get this language all cleared up, so we're all on the same page and going the same direction.
As well as all the other languages.
Right.
It was discussed.
Thank you.
And that's the 13th at 7 p.m. This room, 13th, 7 p.m. Did you hear that, Richard?
Yes, I've already got it on my calendar.
Good man.
That's crazy.
I know this.
Okay, any?
Education, sorry. Kind of in regarding to Richard's question, I'm the president of the Rock and Gem Club here. In our trailer that we take over to the powwow, we have a permit taped on the wall in there, and I took a picture of it, if I could show one of you. It's been in there for several years. I didn't want to pull it off the wall because it might kind of disintegrate, but it's issued by the state of Arizona for purpose of display, which is sort of his question for his gold show, exempting the nonprofit from being required to have permits or licensing to display. So I don't know if I could show that to somebody that's in your permit department. If I have a picture of it, if you wouldn't mind looking at it and seeing if it's a yay or a nay. I don't know how long it's been in our trailer. We've been vending or setting up at the powwow for years. So.
Email a picture to Jim.
Okay, thank you.
That'd be the best.
Thank you.
Okay. Having no further business to come before this council, we're hereby adjourned. Less than 3 hours.
Yeah, just barely.
I mean, I was handling.